After the Revolutionary War, the United States and Britain became great allies. However, the Civil War caused some issues between the two.
I don't think it's right the way you treated the United States during the Civil War.
I don't think it's right that you didn't think about the rest of the world's needs when you cut off the South from trade.
A Union naval blockade prohibited Southern cotton from reaching Britain. British ships helped sneak Southern traders through the Union blockade, which threatened the relationship between Britain and the U.S., but ultimately the matter was dealt with.
Supply first to buy from you.
Then why didn't you at least go through us diplomatically to trade with the South? Why did you go around our back and violate terms of our agreements with trade and military?
Why did you cut off the South in the first place, or else we wouldn't have had to do anything like that?
Because they were rebelling.
They rebelled against you, just like you rebelled against us.
But my cause was greater than theirs.
You still rebelled against us.
No. You were tyrannical and powerful and just power-hungry, and that's all you cared about.
You ever thought?
The end of the Civil War marked a new age of U.S.-British relations, one which was on full display as they cooperated and handled the Boxer Rebellion, despite their increasing commercial rivalry. In the late 1800s... In the late 1800s, German officials denounced the Monroe Doctrine and began to... aggressively pursue the Caribbean islands. Germany gradually lost interest over a decade of naval standoffs. Germany's ambitions only grew throughout the early 1900s, making them a very potential enemy.
Don't keep that in.
The Navy had always been a weak point of the United States. As they rose to the world stage, the U.S. realized it would need to grow their Navy if they wanted to keep up with the European powers, especially Britain. A combination of imperialistic ambitions in the Caribbean, a rising sense of nationalism, and a string of Navy-loving presidents led to the rapid expansion of the United States Navy, including the construction of 16 battleships.
When Woodrow Wilson entered the White House in 1913, his foreign affair intentions were unclear. When war broke out in 1914, the U.S. took a firm stance of neutrality. Neutrality was supported by Irish Americans, German Americans, women, and churches. Theodore Roosevelt also believed strongly in neutrality. The other side believed we should take action against Germany. Can you please come out of there?
No.
You know, people are dying out here.
No.
We've got a lot of stuff going on.
No.
And I don't think we can handle it ourselves.
We
really appreciate
no
if you
way.
Guys would
Jose.
Just come out from your
no.
little shell there.
Not
and,
doing it.
Lend a
no.
hand. Please.
No way in the world.
You
not
know,
a chance.
It's, it'd be real nice of you. Be a... Right then. The U.S. was an established military superpower, and many felt it was our responsibility to interfere. German actions and atrocities had been widely publicized, so the American people were fairly aware of what was going on. In 1915, the Germans sank the RMS Lusitania, killing 128 U.S. civilians and over 1,000 Britons. The Germans didn't give time for the passengers to reach the lifeboats either, which was against the laws of war. This, among other events, contributed to a major shift of American opinion, which favored taking a side against Germany. By mid-1918, the U.S., while not officially affiliated with the Allies, became a major player in the fight against the German menace. U.S. soldiers arrived in France, 10,000 a day. Germany became hopelessly outnumbered and surrendered. Wilson's ideals were crystallized in his 14 points, which were peacemaking guidelines for post-war diplomacy.
Woodrow Wilson's 14 points are as follows.
Listen up, I have some points that I would like for us to keep in mind as we do this peace conference. Point number one, no more secret agreements between countries. Seas shall be free to navigate free trade. Worldwide reduction in weapons Colonial claims over land and regions will be fair. Russia will be allowed to determine its own form of government. German troops will evacuate Belgium. France will regain all territory. The borders of Italy will be established. Austria-Hungary will be an independent country. The Central Powers will evacuate Serbia, Montenegro, and Romania. The Turkish people of the Ottoman Empire will have their own country. Poland shall be an independent country. 14. A League of Nations will be formed that protects the independence of all countries, no matter how big or small. I hope that you keep these points in mind as you are discussing the terms of this conference. Or else.
In World War I, Wilson wanted the U.S. to remain neutral, but German attacks on ships and the Zimmermann Telegram, when Germany tried to have Mexico fight against America, American Congress declared war on Germany in 1917, and then the U.S. went to fight in Europe. In reality, the U.S. never actually hijacked a German submarine to obtain the Zimmermann Telegram. Instead, it was intercepted by British communications and given to U.S. authorities. In the Paris Peace Conference, the Treaty of Versailles was signed on June 28,
1919. Okay.
While the idea of the League of Nations was popular at the time, and the consequences of war showcased the necessity for such an organization, some members of Congress, such as Henry Cabot Lodge, opposed it and thought it would be an expensive distraction from the United States' own interests. As more Americans lamented the consequences of war and voiced their desire to avoid future intervention in foreign affairs at all costs, public opposition to the League of Nations grew. It was perhaps isolationist Warren Harding's election to the office of president that offered the greatest repudiation of the League of Nations and Wilson's interventionism. While Wilson had participated in the creation of the League in Geneva, President Harding would never allow the U.S. to become a member.
You know, honestly, I think President Harding is the biggest piece of cotton candy I've ever seen in my entire life. I mean, I just can't get over them. What are they doing to us? Do they think that they're superior to us? Do they think that we're less of people than them just because we live across the pond? Is that it?
Je m'en fous.
It's me, Victor Emmanuel III, King of Italy. And as my friend Benito would say, who needs the United States? They are enemies of the Italian and European people. Out down there, the outback, it's a dog-eat-dog world, actually.
Big guys,
not dog-eat-dog, we eat some dingoes and kangaroos and emus. Some biscuits.
Just because we put leaves in our water doesn't make us any less of people of them. So what if they could just throw it all into the river? I say we should take them over again. The British Empire shall once again.
Americans reeled from the emotional and financial costs of the war and began to feel as though joining the war effort was a mistake. This caused a lot of disdain to grow in America towards further involvement in European affairs. Despite this, peacemaking efforts in Europe after World War I had involved the U.S. President Wilson wanted any documents to adhere to his 14 points, but this was a pipe dream. What came of the Paris Peace Conference was a treaty that neither Wilson nor the Senate was willing to sign. What ensued after this was a radical shift in U.S. foreign policy, which promoted a stance of isolationism that would last until World War II. Warren Harding won the 1920 presidential election on the promise of staying out of global affairs, and by arguing that the United States needed normalcy and a focus on internal problems. Thus, U.S. foreign policy during the 1920s was characterized by the enactment of isolationist policies.